Systemic sclerosis. Systemic sclerosis is an autoimmune disorder of connective tissue which results in fibrosis affecting the skin, internal organs, and vasculature. It is characterized typically by Raynaud's phenomenon, digital ischemia, sclerodactyly, and cardiac, lung, gut, and renal disease. The peak age of onset is in the 4th and 5th decades, and overall prevalence is 10 to 20 per 1 lakh, with a 4:1 female to male ratio. It is subdivided into diffuse cutaneous systemic sclerosis, 30% of cases, and limited cutaneous systemic sclerosis, 70% of cases. Some patients with limited cutaneous systemic sclerosis have calcinosis and telangiectasia. The prognosis in diffuse cutaneous systemic sclerosis is poor, 5-year survival about 70%. Features that associated with a poor prognosis include older age, diffuse skin disease, proteinuria, high ESR, a low gas transfer factor for carbon monoxide, and pulmonary hypertension. Now, pathophysiology. The cause of systemic sclerosis is not completely understood. There is evidence for a genetic component, and associations with alleles at the HLA locus have been found. The disease occurs in all ethnic groups and race may influence severity. Isolated cases have been reported in which an systemic sclerosis-like disease has been triggered by exposure to silica, dust, vinyl chloride, epoxy resins, and trichloroethylene. There is clear evidence of immunological dysfunction, T lymphocytes, especially those of the Th17 subtype, infiltrate the skin, and there is abnormal fibroblast activation, leading to increased production of extracellular matrix in the dermis, primarily type 1 collagen. This results in symmetrical thickening, tightening, and induration of the skin, that is scleroderma. Arterial and arteriolar narrowing occurs due to intimal proliferation and vessel wall inflammation. Endothelial injury causes release of vasoconstrictors and platelet activation, resulting in further ischemia, which is thought to exacerbate the fibrotic process. Now, the clinical features. Skin. Initially, there is non-pitting edema of fingers and flexor tendon sheets. Subsequently, the skin becomes shiny and taut, and distal skin creases disappear. There can be capillary loss. The face and neck are often involved, with thinning of the leaves and radial furrowing. In some patients, skin thickening stops at this stage. Skin involvement restricted to sides distal to the elbow only, apart from the face, is thus classified as limited cutaneous systemic sclerosis. Involvement proximal to the knee and elbow and on the trunk is classified as diffuse disease, that is diffuse cutaneous systemic sclerosis. Raynaud's phenomenon. This is a universal feature and can precede other features by many years. Involvement of small blood vessels in the extremities may cause critical tissue ischemia, leading to localized distal skin infarction and necrosis. Musculoskeletal features. Arthralgia and flexor tenosynovitis are common. Restricted hand function is due to skin rather than joint disease, and erosive arthropathy is uncommon. Muscle weakness and wasting can result from myositis. Gastrointestinal involvement. Smooth muscle atrophy and fibrosis in the lower two-thirds of the esophagus lead to reflux with erosive esophagitis. Dysphagia and odynophagia may also occur. Involvement of the stomach causes early satiety and occasionally outlet obstruction. Recurrent occult upper GI bleeding may indicate a watermelon stomach. Enteral vascular ectasia up to 20% of patients. Small intestine involvement may lead to malabsorption due to bacterial overgrowth and intermittent bloating, pain, or constipation. Dilatation of bowel due to autonomic neuropathy may cause pseudo-obstruction with nausea, vomiting, abdominal discomfort, and distension. Often oars after food symptoms can mimic those of an acute abdomen and can lead to erroneous laparotomy. Figure 2447 shows systemic sclerosis, hands showing tight, shiny skin, sclerodactyly, flexion contractures of the fingers, and thickening of the left middle finger extensor tendon sheath. And figure 2448 showing typical facial appearance, showing telangiectasias in localized cutaneous systemic sclerosis. Now, pulmonary involvement. Pulmonary hypertension complicates long-standing disease and is 6 times more prevalent in local limited cutaneous systemic sclerosis than in diffuse cutaneous systemic sclerosis. It usually presents with insidiously evolving exertional dyspnea and signs of right heart failure. Interstitial lung disease is common in patients with diffuse cutaneous systemic sclerosis who have topoisomerase 1 antibodies. Scleroderma 70. Dyspnea can evolve slowly over time or rapidly in occasional cases. Renal involvement. One of the main causes of death is hypertensive renal crisis, characterized by rapidly developing accelerated phase hypertension and renal failure. Hypertensive renal crisis is much more likely to occur in diffuse cutaneous systemic sclerosis than in limited cutaneous systemic sclerosis, and in patients with topoisomerase 1 and RNP antibodies. Now, investigations in systemic sclerosis can affect multiple organs, routine hematology, renal, liver, and bone function tests, and urinalysis are essential. ANA is positive in about 70% cases. About 30% of patients with diffuse cutaneous systemic sclerosis have antibodies to topoisomerase 1, scleroderma 70. About 60% of patients with limited cutaneous systemic sclerosis syndrome have anti-centromere antibodies. Chest X-ray, transthoracic echocardiography, and lung function tests are recommended to assess for interstitial lung disease and pulmonary hypertension. Low corrected transfer factor may indicate early pulmonary hypertension. High-resolution lung CT is recommended if interstitial lung disease suspected. If pulmonary hypertension is suspected, right heart catheter measurements should be arranged at a specialist cardiac center. A barium swallow can assess esophageal involvement. A hydrogen breath test can indicate bacterial overgrowth. Now, management. No treatments are available that halt or reverse the fibrotic changes that underlie the disease. The focus of management, therefore, is to slow the effects of the disease on target organs. Raynaud's phenomenon and digital ulcers. Avoidance of cold exposure, use of thermal insulating gloves, socks, and maintenance of a high core temperature all help. If symptoms are persistent, calcium channel blockers, losartan, fluoxetine, and sildenafil have efficacy. Courses of intravenous prostacycline are used for severe disease and critical ischemia. 6 to 8 hours daily for 5 days. The endothelin 1 antagonist bosentan is licensed for treating ischemic digital ulcers, and digital deep tissue health can be maintained with regular use of fusidine hydrocortisone cream. Gastrointestinal complications. Esophageal reflux should be treated with proton pump inhibitors and anti-reflux agents. Rotating courses of antibiotics may be required for bacterial overgrowth, example rifaximin, atetracycline and metronidazole, while metoclopramide or domperidone may help patients with symptoms of dysmotility or pseudo-obstruction. Hypertension. Aggressive treatment with ACE inhibitors is needed, even if renal impairment is present. Joint involvement. This may be treated with analgesics and/or NSAIDs. If synovitis is present and both rheumatoid arthritis, that is an overlap condition which needs treatment on its own merit, and osteoarthritis have been ruled out, low-dose methotrexate can be of value. Progressive pulmonary hypertension. Early treatment with bosentan is required. In severe or progressive disease, heart-lung transplantation may be considered. Interstitial lung disease. Glucocorticoids and pulse intravenous cyclophosphamides are the mainstays of treatment in patients who have progressive interstitial lung disease.